not a head knowledge, but a God heart. We've got a lot of, and I'm not going to go negative on anything or pick on denominations and say ours is better than this or whatever. But what I am going to say is we've got a lot of folks out there, both in and out of church, that do not have an understanding. They're very immature spiritually. And I know we've got some younger Christians in here that often get a question thrown at them that I know that I used to get. Well, it wasn't really a question, it was a statement thrown at me. Said, so you're one of those Southern Baptists, you're once in grace, always in safe in grace. So that means you just sin every day. And all that statement is from anybody who says it is just pure ignorance. And I'm not being negative about it, it's just ignorance is a lack of knowledge and understanding. So, like I said, I don't know if it's going to be a preaching, teaching, reminder, whatever. But we're going to be in the book of Romans this morning. We're going to be in chapter 6. I'm going to start in about verse 12, so I'll give you all a minute to get there. But a God heart, think about it. Do you really, really, and I mean really, do you have that God heart? Or are you working off emotions and head knowledge? Now, I'm not questioning anybody's salvation. Nor would I ever. That's not between me. That's between anybody and the good Lord above. But today I'm going to ask you to search your heart. Search your heart. Do you have that God heart, or do you have head knowledge and emotions? So when folks, it just really, really bothers me how I hear and see these folks out here, and they've got all this head knowledge, but you can, you know, the scripture says you can see Christ in. If you can't see Christ in somebody, he's not there. So, but anyway, chapter 6 of Romans, starting verse 12. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that ye should obey it in lust thereof. Neither yield your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for ye are not under the law, but under grace. What then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace? God forbid. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourself servants to obey, his servants ye are to whom ye obey, whether of sin unto death or of obedience unto righteousness. But God be thanked that ye were the servants of sin, that ye have obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine which delivered you, being then made free from sin, ye became servants of righteousness. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, God, I just come before you this morning humbly asking, God, I know that I'm nothing more than a man, and I'm not worthy to stand on this pulpit today, God. God, I pray that your word, your message comes out and is heard here today, God. I pray that it be your will done and not mine. God, I ask that you set me aside and you just use this vessel to your pleasing, God, for your honor and your glory, God. Because again, I know I'm not worthy of it. God, I also pray if there be anybody in here today that maybe don't know your Son as Lord and Savior, that your words today will prick a heart and will bring to salvation. Or if there be one that need to renew or refresh their walk with you, God, I pray that they'll come forward. God, I feel that there's somebody in the house today that's burdened, Heavenly Father, God. God, I pray that you lift that burden off those folks. You make their walk a little easier. You lay your light yoke on them and you take the burden as you promised you would. Bless God, bless your son's precious and holy name. Amen. All right.
A God heart.
A God heart. You know, as the scripture says here, it says, let not sin therefore reign in your mortal bodies. Let not sin. That means we're supposed to put that away. We're supposed to resist that sinful temptations. You're going to have temptations. You're going to have confrontations on a daily basis. On a daily basis, your daily walk is filled. We walk out of the house. Turn the TV on. We've got sin all around us. But let's stop letting that sin run us, or even deter us, or even encourage us. God's blessed about every preacher that stood behind this pulpit in the last year to preach on spiritual maturity and spiritual growth. So the only way we're going to let sin not have dominion over us is what? Bury our nose in the Word. Study God's Word. So, like I said, we're going to stop letting it. And you talk about this, neither yield ye your members. So stop using your members of sin. Stop giving in to that sin just because it's in your face all the time, every day. If it's that hindrance on you, pick this up more often. Pick this up more often. You know, I got to thinking the other day, and I've gotten real, I'll be honest with you, church, I've got real bad about this. Scrolling through Facebook, one of the worst things that you can do, because before you realize it, you start scrolling down that, and what are you doing? You're there for an hour. How much of God's Word could have been read in that hour? Now, don't get me wrong, it's a good platform, and it'll work, but you've got to not let it control you. You've got to keep it under rein. So stop letting this stuff out here control you. Let God's Word control you, lead you, guide you, direct you. Because if God puts it on you to get on Facebook and post a piece of Scripture because that's what God's put on your heart, absolutely that piece of Scripture is not going to fall null and void. It's going to hit somebody's heart out there somewhere. And that may be the piece of Scripture that leads somebody to the Lord. But you know what? What you see is you see that piece of Scripture and you scroll down two or three and you see all these other profanities being spread. So for every one piece of Scripture, there's five pieces of profanity. So how much God heart do we have out there? And you know what the sad thing is I'm seeing about these posts with the profanities on them? Are you all seeing it too? Who's posting them? Who's sharing them? I'm not judging anybody, and none of us do. But the question again is posed, do they have a God heart? Do they have a true God heart? So when we're talking about a God heart and head knowledge, and the reason this scripture came to me is because I've always had people say this to you. So since you've got eternal security and you're under grace, that means that you can be saved today and sin like the devil tomorrow. No, Paul asked that very question. He says, what then shall we sin because we are not under the law but under grace? And he says, God forbid, no. So whenever we accept Christ, we should open our heart up, because God will prick your heart. Then we need to tear our heart open and say, God, use me. We need to fill our heart with God's Word. Because if you've truly accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, your desire won't be to do those sins and those bad things. You're still going to stump your toe. Don't get me wrong. You're still going to mess up. It's part of the sanctification process, where J.D. hit here. Part of the sanctification process. You're going to stump your toe. You're going to mess up. But do you really have that God heart? You know, God's blessed me the last couple weeks to talk to a few people, and and they're starting to, I see some people starting to understand some things, but they still go on, why then, they start asking themselves questions and saying, you know, what's the deal? So if I'm saved, why am I still sinning? Okay, I've got a God heart. I've given my God heart to God. Yeah, but are you sinning on purpose? Are you intentionally going out and looking and lusting? And when I say lust, I mean anything that piques a desire in you is a lust. Period, point blank. Why are you still going out and lusting after this pontoon boat or this truck or this money or these drugs? And they said, well, you know, I don't understand. I said, well, it's real simple. Keep injecting God's word into you, and you'll change from idolizing that lustful product to God. The more God's word fills your heart, the more you're going to lust after God. Amen. And I'd rather lust after God the Father as anything. But you know what? Even standing up here and being called to preach God's word, we still catch ourselves fall into those temptations of the world sometimes. We do. It's just because we're still human. We may stay in God's word all the time, but there's still the old adversaries out there. And that's why it's so hard on especially Southern Baptists, as it were, because they think, oh yeah, he's Southern Baptist, he's all right, he's sinned, it's okay. No, they don't understand, because they don't get the fact that we don't want to do this. We don't want to stump our toe. We try to serve the Lord. Amen. But everybody will fall short. Some fall a little shorter than others. Some do it more publicly than others. But here's where they go back and they start going on about that. And when I'm talking about these other people, I'm talking about people from, and please forgive this, but I don't like talking denominations, because I don't like denominations. I've grown to really not like denominations in a lot of aspects and a lot of avenues. Because what has denominations done to a lot of God's, Christ's body? It's divided it. So that means that denomination is what? A wedge of the devil. Because we're called to be one body of Christ, right? That don't matter the name over the door. Don't matter the name over the door. It should. Because we're one body of Christ. So what's getting me, what my point's driving at on this right here today, is having a God heart. You've got these, if you've got that God heart, you see somebody stump their toe, you're going to run down and you're going to pick them up and you're going to help them. You're going to love them and try to love them through and help them pass the problem, right? And we're not going to enable them in the problem. We're still going to swat their hands because they've done wrong and let God swat their tail. But we're going to love them and help them through it and pray them through it. But you've got other, again, I'm going to say this, denominations, that as soon as they see a different denomination stump their toe and fall, what are they doing? See, I told you that bunch over there going to hell. I told you, I told you, I told you, I told you. So do they have a God heart? Or are they indoctrinated with false doctrines and false teachings? So I guess where we're going with this God heart today, most of these folks that I've talked to, man, they can quote scripture to you front, back, forwards, inside out, upside down. But you know what? The devil quoted scripture to Jesus too when he was tempting him. So again, I'm not judging anybody's salvation. But what I am getting at is that even when we do the best that we can do, if we don't have God in it, it's still nothing but water in a mud hole. If we don't put God in everything and God first, I had a conversation with a preacher yesterday. He said he's got three priorities in his life. And I love the order that he put them in. God's first. Family second. Church is third. I love that priority list, because where does that squarely sandwich his family? Right in the middle. Now, whenever he's talking about church, he's talking about the church that God's blessing him to pastor and use right now. But what's happening with his family? It's getting squarely in the middle of God's word. And to watch his little young ones run around, you can see Christ all over. You can see Christ all over them in every little action. And I'm talking little 4 or 5 year olds. All the way up to an 11-year-old, that you can just see Christ all over them. So you can see a God heart in them. They're not judging anybody. They're not ridiculing somebody if they make a mistake. So why do we ridicule, or why do we get ridiculed when we stump our toe? Or, you know, and or better yet, why do we ridicule when we see somebody else stump their toe? Do we truly have that God heart? I'm asking you today, do you have a God heart? We get in such a habit. And that negative judging of people causes us to take that slippery slope away from God heart to head knowledge. Do you truly have a God heart today? Can you look past somebody's downfalls, pitfalls, and love that person regardless of what their pitfall is? Think about it for just a minute. Going on in with this while you're all pondering that, you know, I went through verse 15 there. It says, "What then shall we sin because we are not under the law, but under grace, as God forbid?" In verse 16 it says, "Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourself servants, ye obey?" I'm going to stop right there for just a minute. The rest of that verse finishes out, but I'm going to stop right there. Which servant, who are you going to serve? It's a real question. It's a real question to ask yourself right now. Not, well, that's, you know, whatever, blah, 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 whatever. Which servant are you going to serve right now? Because here's the true question. If somebody's in here or somebody hears this message that's not saved, that decision could be that quick. Who are you going to serve? Are you going to serve the Lord? Are you going to serve the devil? The decision can be that quick. It's not that. Scripture says you can't serve two, you can't have two masters. You'll love one, hate the other. Paul reinforces it right here in these writings, and because he's asking you, to whom are you going to serve? Who are you going to pledge your allegiance to? That's what that verse is asking. Who are you going to serve? And anytime he's mentioning in this particular piece of scripture, are you going to serve righteousness or unrighteousness? He's asking, are you going to serve God? Are you going to serve the devil? Are you going to serve heaven? Are you going to serve hell? You can't have it both ways. But a lot of this right here goes back to that when he's talking about these serving, asking which one he's going to serve or which one they're going to serve. He's really asking them, do you have a God heart? Because he's seeing them sit in the pews or in the sanctuaries or in the tabernacles or whatever you want to call it. He's seeing them sitting there. Oh, I'm just an ideal Christian today. And then he's seeing them throughout the week serving a different master. So he's asking them, do you have a God heart? Because you're doing great. You're serving on Sunday. From Monday through Saturday, that's a lot of questions going on there. Do you have a God heart? Do you have a God heart? Or do you have a head knowledge and head wisdom? Because again, I see folks, I know preachers, okay? And other denominations, but I know preachers
who have looked at me and told me that I was on my way to hell because I was a Baptist preacher. Looked me in my face and told me that. I had another preacher looked at me and told me that if somebody came to the altar, this is how little understanding they've got about grace. If somebody came to the altar and professed Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, and we had the baptistry full of water, and they died from there to there with a massive heart attack, they were going to hell. Now, how much knowledge do they have about grace? How much knowledge do they have about grace? How much emphasis are they putting on the water in the baptistry? They've turned it into works. So do they have a God heart or a head knowledge? Are they wanting to stroke their own feathers? Who are they serving? And I'm not trying to pick and be negative on denominations or doctrines or whatever, because there isn't but one doctrine. Only one. It's not City Missionary Baptist doctrine. It's not Southern Baptist doctrine. It's not this doctrine. It's not that doctrine. It's God's Word is the only doctrine that there is. If anything, anybody or anything is done differently, said differently, acts differently, anything different than this right here is an abomination before God's eyes. If it don't come right out of God's Word, it's an abomination before His eyes. And it is false doctrine. False teaching. And that'll send you to hell. But when you're talking about when you're talking to these other folks, they're going to tell you, and they're going to try to fill your head full of this stuff that, oh, you're one of those always saved people. You sin all day long. You know what? They're ignorant. You know, Paul uses that term, brethren. I don't want you to be ignorant of this. He don't want you to be unknowledgeable. That's why we, as God heart Christians, not just head knowledge. God heart, we don't get defensive with these people. That's the big thing right there. Don't argue with them. Bring out scripture and quote it to them. Says, well, right here's what my scripture says. What then shall we sin because we are not under law, but under grace? God forbid. Should that not answer the question very, very, very simply? Very simply. Okay. When you're talking to these folks and they're going on and they're going on about all this stuff, and you look at them and you tell them, you know, God be thanked that you were that you were the servant of sin. I thank God He allowed me to walk that servant's life. I know some of you are probably thinking, now, whoa, hold it here. I'm thankful God allowed me to walk that life for a while. I am. But I'm more thankful that from the heart, that's the key of that verse right there, from the heart, that form of doctrine which delivered you. So what form of doctrine was that delivered you? The good form, the awesome doctrine, the one true doctrine, right? That form of doctrine is a pattern of teaching. It took a lot of years. God's Word put in my heart a lot of times. But that's the good doctrine. Okay? It says, being then made from sin, you have become servants of righteousness. I am thankful that God made me a servant of righteousness. I know that whenever I accepted Christ, that I said, God, use me however you want to use me. Put me wherever you want to put me. And then when He put the call to preach on me, I said, anywhere but there. Because I am not worthy to get nowhere near a pulpit. And you know what He said? No, you're not. But I'm putting you there. So that's where I can use you. I pray God uses me from right here. But I pray God continues to fill my heart. I pray God holds that anger back, holds that pride back. I pray that God remove that thorn from my side, because that's one of my thorns. Okay. But mostly I pray God allows me to be able to educate the ignorant of His Word, to show them what a God heart is in a truly Christian loving conversation. Because these other denominations, I'm not going to doubt anybody's salvation there. Because when we cross through the pearly gates, there's not going to be a denomination. There's not going to be a Church of Christ. There's not going to be a Baptist. There's not going to be a Catholic. There's not going to be a Pentecostal. There's not going to be none of them. It's the same way in heaven that it's supposed to be and it's called to be right here. We're supposed to be one body. One church. Under one head, and that is Jesus Christ. But we've allowed these denominations to come in. We've allowed the adversary to come through and drive wedges. Now, as you sit back and you think about this, how does something wrote 2,000 years ago have to play in this? Well, because God knew that something was going to have to be defined about grace, mercy, and understanding. So God blessed Paul with the words to put in here to help us understand and not be ignorant of his doctrine. Not to be ignorant of his doctrine. In John 8:31-32, Jesus says, If you continue in my word, then ye are my disciples indeed. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. That's exactly what God has put on my heart about this particular piece of scripture. Is that everybody should know the truth. We shouldn't allow these wrong doctrines to drive wedges in God's church. God's church. His church. Jesus Christ come here, died on the cross, said, I'm the cornerstone. My church will be firmly built upon me. Okay? So God knew back then that Paul needed to write this to keep us from being ignorant of what grace really stood for and how grace really works. Okay? So we have to understand that. And the other thing we need to remember, and this is later on in Romans in chapter 6, it's actually the last verse of chapter 6, the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now I want you to think about that for just a minute. It says it specifically right there. How many times have you had people be ignorant of eternal security, ignorant of eternal life, what that means? They're ignorant of salvation and what it means. And I'm not using the word ignorant negatively. They don't have understanding. I want to remind everybody of that. I'm not being negative, but they just don't have an understanding of eternal security. They don't have an understanding of salvation. They don't have an understanding of grace. And it says it very plainly more than one time. Brother Paul was preaching or giving a message Wednesday night, talking about you shouldn't preach the word unless you got four or five pieces of scripture to back it up, right? Well, I'm only giving one or two pieces tonight or today about this. But there are multiple pieces of scripture that mention what? Eternity or eternal salvation or eternally saved, eternal walk with the Lord, however it's worded, or in that particular verse, it still means eternally secure in your salvation. Now, that person with head knowledge, they think that they're eternally secure. But they go out and serve the bed every day in their daily walk. And I'm not judging anybody. But have they really give their heart to the Lord? You know, I've heard multiple stories of folks that served in churches for 20, 30 years. They even served as deacons and teachers and leaders in the church. They finally came to it and said, you know what, I have to accept Christ. I've had it here, but not here. If that person had died and took their last breath before they did that, even as they laid in front of the church as a deacon of the church, whenever he stepped before the Father, what would have been said? Depart from me, you worker of iniquity, for I never knew. And those are the same ones who will look at the Father and say, but did we not cast out demons and devils in your name? Yeah, but you missed heaven and split the gates of hell open by 18 inches. Depart from me, you worker of iniquity. Think about that for just a minute. It's awesome to have the head knowledge and head wisdom of God. But if you don't have the God heart for Him to give you the discernment up here, this head knowledge is kind of useless, right? I mean, unless you let it in your heart, it's kind of useless to have it up here.
So, and one of the last things that I want to really touch on, and you know, I won't keep everybody too long today. I'm trying not to be that lying preacher that says that, but the last thing I really want to touch on today, the last thing I want to leave you with, I guess, is a little note to go along with that God heart thing, is that if thee shall confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved.
Amen.
Now, a reason I wanted to pull that piece out there and kind of throw that to you is, you know, I hear a lot of people talking about salvation. And this goes back to that God heart. Not having a God heart, they're complicating salvation. Because it says it right there, right? It says, believe in thine heart. What does that believe? The word believe means faith as well. I've got faith in my heart that my Lord and Savior stretched across that cross for me and was nailed to it. And it only took one drop of His blood to cleanse me. But man, at the blood that He shed for everybody. But people that don't have the God heart, which in turn turns into that discernment that God gives you here when you're reading and studying, to be able to understand whether it be eternal security or salvation or whatever, if they don't understand it, it's hard for them to grasp something as easy as this. And then they say, they want to go back to that, well, you have to confess. You have to confess. Yeah, there's a confession that has to be made. There is. You have to confess to the Father. You have to confess to the Father. I am a lowly, dirty, low-life piece of trash sinner. But I am so thankful, and I believe in my heart, not just in my head. Don't make an emotional response. It's got to be from here. The heart has to be pricked. Because there's a cutoff here. Okay? If the heart's not pricked, you can have all this that you want. But you're going to miss heaven. About 18 inches. So my question to you today is, do you have a God heart? Are you able to talk to those folks? Well, I don't care what denomination, because I don't like denominations, I'm sorry. Regardless, can you talk to them with a God heart and let Christ's love show shine through you? And then you've also got to pay attention to who's talking to you. Are they letting Christ's love show through them? Or are they just trying to get you to take on a doctrine that's
against this doctrine. It's against this doctrine. I prayed about this message when God gave it to me. I prayed that it would touch somebody, and it's nothing new to anybody here. We've all heard it. We've all studied it. But God put it on my heart that somebody needed to hear that. I don't even know. It might have been me that needed to hear it. But God put it on my heart that somebody needed to hear that in here. Somebody had a question. Somebody was just didn't understand, or somebody maybe had been approached by somebody that said, well, you're just a this, or you're just a that, or you're not really saved. It's got to happen here. Right here, in thy heart. Right here. Head knowledge won't get you to heaven. Head knowledge will get you in hell. Heart. Do you have a God heart? If you're in here today and you're saved and you're just thinking, you know what? Let the distractions of the world overtake me. Or I let the distractions of the world just get me off sight just a little bit. As the singer's coming. I let the distractions just get me a little bit. Altar's open. Altar's always open, church. We should wet this altar every day with the tears of the saints. Amen. Because I know that every one of us has got something we can lay down at the altar. If you're in here today and you're burdened, you're heavy hearted, and you want God to open your heart up more and give you better discernment over His Word, altar's open. If you're in here today and you don't know Christ as your Lord and Savior, it just takes that first step to the hardest. That's the hardest step to take, that first step. Because the devil's holding you down hard right there where you're at. After that, you'll be up front. I can't save you. Johnny can't save you. Fonso can't save you. But we all know a man.
Amen.
Who hung on a cross. We all know a man. Who spread his arms out. And all you have to do is believe in your heart. Believe with thy heart. Believe with thy heart. Do you have a God heart today?